Hello aspirants, welcome to another session of the daily newspaper analysis. This video is brought to you by the Gurudev Academy. My name is Ashwin. Firstly, we look at the topics that we are going to look at. These are the topics that we are going to read. It is going to be a very interesting video. Firstly, on the front page, this was the article. The article talks here about the freebies. Okay, freebies. Freebies are the things that are promised during an election, that a party promises in its manifesto that after a party comes to power, they will provide such and such things which are free. Like some of the states are trying to provide free electricity up to certain units. Okay, so these are the freebies, and recently the Prime Minister has been vocal about it. The Prime Minister has been asking the administration to avoid freebies here. The matter has reached to Supreme Court. The Supreme Court, under a writ petition filed by a person, it is looking into three matters here. Firstly, it is asking whether freebies that are provided here are violating elections, whether they are not helping for the elections to be conducted in a fair and free manner. Secondly, the petitioner here asked for the seizure of election symbols of those parties who are guaranteeing freebies. So, firstly, we will look at what these election symbols, who gives this election symbols in India. So, Election Commission, okay, it is the agency which is responsible for allocating election symbols as well as party symbols in the country. This election symbols are provided under the Election Symbols Reservation and Allotment Order of 1968. Okay, under this rule, the election symbols are provided. Then the petitioner also asks for deregulation, deregistration of parties which are providing freebies here. Again, this power is exercised by the Election Commission. If any party is registered as a national party or a state party, the party can be deregistered as a political party by the Election Commission only. And this power is exercised under the Section 29 of the Representation of the 1951 Act. So the Supreme Court has asked the government here whether the promise of these freebies are irrational and should be stopped. The Supreme Court here has asked the opinion of the government here. The matter has been referred to both the Finance Commission as well as the Law Commission. So in coming days, if there is some development regarding to this, we will look ahead. Moving ahead. So recently we had this news where Joe Biden has been visiting the West Asia, right? So West Asia is again a very important region when it comes to geopolitics. There have been a few significant developments when we look at it. Firstly, there has been a reorientation of US policies. Some of the reorientation that has been taking place from the original policy, that is reworked JCPOA, that is your Joint Comprehensive Plan of Action. This Joint Comprehensive Plan of Action was originally signed between Iran and other Western countries. Okay, so this was signed so that Iran would stop its nuclear enrichments. Okay, this deal was signed during the Obama administration, but later when the Trump administration came to power, US came out of this deal and Iran started re-enriching its uranium. Then right now the US is working with JCPO, working with Iran to get back into this agreement. The agreement will be reworked, okay, the agreement will be redesigned. And secondly, troops pull out from Afghanistan. Okay, since the troops have been pulling out from US, what is happening is there has been a fear of regional securities when it comes to Afghanistan. When you look at the map of Afghanistan again, Afghanistan is a very important region which connects Russia with this Central Asian countries. So Afghanistan is a very important region, not only when we look at through the eyes of world, but also through the eyes of India, because India wanted to connect through Afghanistan to Central Asian countries as well as the European countries. So troops pulling out of Afghanistan, the US troops pulling out, has had a major implication on the regional security. Thirdly, support to democracies and distancing from the regional autocrats and dictatorship. So US has been maintaining a distance with Saudi Arabia here. Okay, Saudi Arabia, which has always been a natural partner of US. Okay, right now US is trying to maintain a distance from Saudi Arabia because of two things. Firstly, the present administration that is there in US has always backed democracies all over the country. Since Saudi Arabia is still autocratic, US is trying to make have a fair distance with them and support those regional countries which are forming democracies over there. So these is the realignment, reorientation that is being happening when it comes to West Asian countries. Now when we look at the article, what are the previous issues? The previous issues for US when it comes to West Asia have been two main issues, that is Israel-Palestine conflict as well as the Iran issue. See, Iran has always been a natural foe of US here. So these are the previous issues. When we look at the present issues, that is your Russia-Ukraine conflict as well as food crisis, these all issues together, previous issue as well as the present issue, these have forced US to realign, to reorient their West Asia policy. Then when Joe Biden, he visited West Asian region, one of the major development was his meeting with the Saudi Arabian prince. See, so Saudi Arabia and US have been having this sore relationship, because what has happened is due to the killing of the journalist Khashoggi, the CIA from US has accused the Salman bin Abdul, who is the head of the Saudi Arabian, who is the king of Saudi Arabia. So he has been accused by the CIA for the killing. From that time, there has been a sore relation between Saudi Arabia and US, and Saudi Arabia is trying to get very close with China and Russia right now. Okay, so again, this visit by Joe Biden to Saudi Arabia was very significant. During these visit, they concentrated on issues such as 5G tech development, defense cooperation, and also Saudi Arabia is going to invest in one of the platforms that has been established by US, that is US Partnership for Global Infrastructure and Investment. Okay, these are the issues that were talked about when there was the visit from Joe Biden. But what are the issues that were ignored? See, the issues like release of political prisoners, easing of traveling restrictions for those dual citizens who are both the citizens of US as well as Saudi Arabia, and also you're granting clemency to some of the prisoners. Okay, so these are the issues that were ignored when Joe Biden came to Saudi Arabia. Why? When we look at the issues, okay, positives from the visit, when he visited to Saudi Arabia, firstly is that UN mediated truce in Yemen. See, Yemen is going through a civil war period. It is having a civil war, and mainly forces of Saudi Arabia have been fighting these Houthi rebellions. Okay, so these Houthi rebellions are supported by Iran again. So since the visit has been taken place, the UN, okay, the UN has been conducting mediation to bring peace in this Yemen region. This is one of the significant. Secondly, opening of Saudi Arabian space, airspace for civilian aircraft to and fro from Israel. This will strengthen the Abraham Accord. Okay, this will strengthen the Abraham Accord that has already been signed between the West Asian countries and Israel. Okay, so this easing of tension between Israel and the West Asian countries will help US in turn. These were some of the positives that happened when Joe Biden visited Saudi Arabia here. Then when we look at overall, what is the importance of West Asia for US? There are two main importance. Firstly, it is your energy situation. See, energy situation is important because right now the gas prices and oil prices in US are rising, okay, and it is predicted that in coming months it will rise again. So in such a situation, US is depending directly on Saudi Arabia to increase their production, okay, to increase their production not only for themselves but also when it comes to Europe. Okay, so Europe, what is happening right now in Europe? Due to war situation and due to the sanctions that have been put on Russia has been threatening Europe that they are going to cut down the oil supplies, or if the sanctions are going to be more severe, Russia is completely going to stop the export of oil to European nations. See, European nations need Russian oil because during winter months, most of these countries in Germany and all, they use the gas that is provided from Russia to make their houses very warm. So since the oil and the gas availability is going down in the market, US is trying to pursue Saudi Arabia to increase the production of gases in Saudi Arabia. Again, the implication for Europe here are short term in the sense that coming winter months, okay, in the coming winter months they need gas. So if Saudi Arabia is ready to increase the supply of gas, it will help Europe here. Secondly, Okay. Secondly, we look at the long term here, long term, it will reduce the dependency of European countries on Russia, and this will not help Russia to have any war in Ukraine or any other part of Europe. Fine. So these are the energy situation. Then when we look at one more important regional organization which has come in news when we look at the recent visit of Joe Biden is I2U2. I2U2 has the member of your Israel, India, and then you have UAE and US. Okay, so this organization, when we look at it, it is called as West Asia Quad. West Asia Quad. Okay, so what is happening is this right now, whatever this organization I2U2, it is mainly working on two main issues, that is your food security and energy security. Okay, it is right now, it is working on food security and energy security in long term. In long term, what the goal of US here is to integrating the region of West Asia and South Asia. See, this grouping, when you look at it, okay, Israel, India, UAE and US. Okay, so here they are trying to counter two main powers in the region, that is Saudi Arabia and your Iran. Okay, Saudi Arabia and Iran, to counter this, they have formed this organization. The US has formed this organization. Right now, it is just working on food security and energy security since it is a new organization. But later on, okay, later on, what the attempt of US here is that they are trying to integrate West Asia and South Asia so that West Asia becomes secure for US. Okay, so we look at it if some other article comes on this. This is the overall structure of the article. This is how you have to dissect the article. Okay, then. So, a path to global connectivity here, there are a few things. Firstly, we have to know, then we will go into the article here. Firstly, it talks about non-terrestrial network. Non-terrestrial network means, okay, here satellites, okay, the satellites are not placed on, are placed in very low earth orbit, okay, they are placed in low earth orbit, which are at a height of 1200 kilometers. So, non-terrestrial network means, since now, for network, for communication, for connectivity network, we are using towers. But later on, what the technology is going to be developed is non-terrestrial network with the satellites. Okay, satellites, like small satellites, are going to, or even nano satellites, okay, they are going to be deployed at the height of 1200 kilometers, that is your low earth orbit, and from there we will be having connectivity. The connectivity here will be both from your non-terrestrial network plus the terrestrial network. Okay, both will be connected together. So we already have a global players here that are working in this field. That is, we have Starlink, which is owned by Elon Musk. Okay, they have already deployed 2500 satellites in low earth orbit. Then we have OneWeb, which is promoted by your Bharati Airtel. Here again, 648 satellites have been placed. Okay, so already the work has started to connect both the non-terrestrial network as well as the terrestrial network here. When we look at the uses of non-terrestrial network and terrestrial network, service connectivity between satnets and terrestrial network. Satnets here are your satellite networking. Okay, satellite network. Okay, so here service continuity. Imagine if there is a disaster, okay, and your tower is being destroyed. Connectivity is lost at that point of time. To continue the connectivity, the satellites can be used. The satellites which provide us with connectivity network and all, they can be used here. That is one of the. Secondly, underserved and your unserved. So there is kind some population which still does not have interconnectivity because they live in far off remote places. Okay, imagine if a tribal community is living in a deep forest area, they cannot be connected using the terrestrial network of towers. So hence, such people or such population can be connected with the non-terrestrial network. Such people can be connected with the satellite links that are available at the low earth orbit. Lastly, it talks about multicasting and broadcasting same content over larger area. Fine. So imagine if we want to broadcast a particular content, if we want to broadcast a particular movie or something, that particular content can be broadcasted over a larger area simultaneously. Fine. Like if there is some live event or live sport happening and we want to display or broadcast it over a large area at the same time, this can be made possible using the sat nets that are available. Okay. But what are the issues? When we look at the issues here, firstly, the frequency how much of the frequency has to be allotted, that has to be determined here, that depends, that is the major factor when it comes to the satellite connectivity. Then it talks about higher cost for consumer equipments. This is true again because development of satellite, launching of a satellite is on a higher cost side here. Then interconnection of satnets with terrestrial public phones. We already have public phones that have been established. We already have mobile phones that are in use. So connecting with them, with the satellites, is going to be a huge task here. When we look at this low Earth orbit satnets, okay, they are 1.4 times faster than the fiber network, and also they increase the global coverage here. Okay, so these are the things, these are the issues, these are the benefits of having your satnets, that is your non-terrestrial networks. What has the Indian government done here? Indian government, under the National Digital Communication Policy of 2018, has been encouraging of local manufacturing of satellites here. And to achieve this, the government has established two main organizations, that is your NSIL, New Space India Limited, as well as InSpace, India Space Program, that we did yesterday. Okay, in yesterday's news video, we have done both the NSIL as well as in space. Please look at the yesterday's video. So, under National Digital Communication Policy, we are increasing not only the encouraging not only the local manufacturing of satellites, we are also trying to increase and encourage the private player partnership in the Indian space infrastructure. Okay, so we look ahead, what are the steps that the government will be taking, since the 5G spectrum will be sold. So we look ahead if the government is trying to include the NTN, that is a non-terrestrial connectivity as well here. Okay, moving ahead. So there is this article that was published today, which says that center to buy arms worth ₹28,732 crores. Again, when you look at it, there is one important council mentioned here, that is your Defense Acquisition Council. Okay, so this Defense Acquisition Council is responsible for all the defense related acquisition that happens in our country. Fine. When we look at it, this Defense Acquisition Council, it is mainly responsible for policies and acquisition for all the three services, that is your Indian Army, Air Force, as well as the Navy. Also, it is involved in the acquisition of the Indian Coast Guards as well. Okay, and then this DAC is headed by the Ministry of Defense. Also, this DAC was formed post Kargil War. Okay, it is not a recent council that was formed. It was formed after the Kargil War in 2001. Then, moving ahead, very important news that has come today, that is India adds 5 more Ramsar sites. Okay, India adds 5 more Ramsar sites. When you look at it, firstly you have to know what is a wetland. Okay, so wetland is a transition zone. It is a transition zone between land and water. Okay, so it is not completely under land, it is not completely under water, it is a transition zone. Right? So wetland, when you look at this, these are marshes. Okay, marshes, ferns, there are different types of wetlands. This is the definition of wetland. It is inundated or saturated, okay, it is by the surface or groundwater, and then it has typical vegetations like adapted in both the saturated conditions as well as your freshwater conditions. Both are available in your Ramsar sites, that is your wetlands. When we come to Ramsar sites, Ramsar is a convention that was established in 1975 by UNESCO. Ramsar conventions try to include the Ramsar sites. Ramsar sites are wetlands which are under threat, which are going through a technological changes where man-made changes are happening and destroying the overall ecology of wetlands. See, wetlands are a very important part of our ecology, because wetlands are the most productive areas. Okay, they are the most productive and most habitable areas in the world. That is why Ramsar sites are important. See, so in India, previously we had 49 sites, and now with the addition of 5 more sites, India totally now has 54 Ramsar sites. So which all Ramsar sites have been added, they have mentioned here, that is your Karikili bird sanctuary, Pallikaranai marsh reserve forest, Pichavaram mangroves in Tamil Nadu, Satke Sagar Madhya Pradesh, and Palana wetland in Mizoram. These are the wetlands that have been added. So when we look at few facts when it comes to Indian Ramsar sites, first, okay, the first Ramsar site in India was Chilka Lake, Odisha. The largest is in Sundarbans, okay, and the smallest wetland is the Renuka wetland that is present in Himachal Pradesh. The states with the highest number of wetlands is Uttar Pradesh. Okay, please note down these facts that we have mentioned here, and also map under mapping. Please mark all the 54 locations of these Ramsar sites. Moving ahead, so this is about the Vande Bharat train. The third Vande Bharat train has been launched in the recent budget. The government said that in the next 3 years, we are going to have 400 Vande Bharat trains. Right now, there are two Vande Bharat trains that are running. Firstly, Delhi to Katra. Okay, Delhi to Katra is one of the Vande Bharat train. Second one is from Delhi to Varanasi. The third Vande Bharat train will be running in South India. For now, they have not mentioned the location. Once it is mentioned, please look at it. So, when we look at few facts about Vande Bharat train, it is also called as Train 18. Okay, it is also called as Train 18. It is semi-high speed train. Okay, it is semi-high speed train, not a high speed train. It is a semi-high speed train with a max speed of 160 kilometers per hour. Okay, the specialty of this train is that each car of the train is powered. Okay, it is powered. Each car of the train is powered. Also, there are some facilities like intelligent braking system, automatic door system, GPS system for assistance of passengers, as well as CCTV facilities. Fine. So, these are the few of the points of Vande Bharat train. So, that's it. That's it from the today's analysis. As I mentioned in the Sunday special class that we did, in the coming Sunday's class, we are going to do the Yojana of June month. So, please read the Yojana June month. When I discuss, it will be very easy for you all to understand the topic. Fine. So, please follow us on these social media handles. Please follow us on YouTube, Telegram, Instagram, as well as on Facebook. Do write your answers in the comment section. Thank you.